Today we'll be talking about chapter 13, section 1, and it's called Cultures Clash on the Prairie. We'll be talking about, yes, how the cattle industry boomed in the 1800s, but we'll also be talking about the land that we took from Native Americans, folks who were living here first, the Plains Indians. As we talk about the Great Plains, we're looking at what is today Kansas, Texas, even the flat parts of Colorado, everything east of the Rockies, west of the Mississippi, a huge chunk of land that takes about 2 days to drive across. There were many people living out there before we came to this area, and those are the folks that we're going to begin talking about. And so, first, I wanted to help you understand how important this area is. The Great Plains is the entire west central portion of the United States. Everything west of the Mississippi, east of the Rocky Mountains. It's a place with a beauty of its own. I drive through it every year. I love it. I think it's fascinating to see just how large this area is. There were many people living there. There were many buffalo, as you can see in this clip. Millions. There were once more buffalo than there were people on this continent. Sea of these large animals. Again, hundreds of millions. Now, they're on the endangered species list. We nearly wiped them out. There were people who made their entire way of life off of these buffalo that you can see. The Sioux were the largest of these people, but there were many, the Comanche, the Apache, many, many Western tribes, the Cheyenne. Did you know you're named after a tribe?
Yeah.
So these people made their life off of what they had. They were often nomadic. Because buffalo travel. They migrate from place to place. And many of these people were nomadic as a result. They didn't own the land. They dwelt upon it. However, different tribes, over the thousands of years they'd lived here, had come to lay claim to certain hunting lands. They had fought wars just like we had over these lands, and they had laid claim to them for many, many years. But the buffalo could provide many basic necessities. Hide could become clothing or shelter. The meat could obviously be staple food, sinew for rope, bones for structures and medicine. Everything was used. This is what a buffalo looks like. Maybe you've seen one, maybe you haven't. Thankfully, they are making a comeback. We have recently taken them off of the endangered species list, but they are still a protected species. By the end of the 1800s, there were less than 1,000 of these creatures left on the planet.
What?
From hundreds of millions to near extinction. These animals provided a way of life for most people living in the Great Plains of what is today the United States. How did these people live? Most nomadic peoples live in what we call a stateless society, meaning no formal government. They are nomadic. They typically dwell in tribes, which is why we talk about the Sioux tribe, the Cheyenne tribe, the Arapaho, Apache, etc. These tribes evolve in natural ways from family groups that speak the same language. They spend enough time together that over generations they develop a language of their own. Most of their faiths, their religions, center around a blend of animism, of spirits. These people were living in a way that many Europeans had not seen for thousands of years. Their culture had remained relatively unchanged for thousands of years. And it's fascinating. They worshiped the sky, the earth, the wind, the spirits. This is again called animism. Children learned through an oral tradition, through stories or myths passed down through the generations. Life itself was communal. The tribes shared everything. People filled specific roles of warrior or hunter or gatherer or builder. Again, this is the old way.
Plains covered the area between the Rocky Mountains on the west and the Mississippi River on the east. They were huge grasslands that stretched more than 2,000 miles across from the north to the south. The Native Americans who lived there were best known for their bison or buffalo hunting skills. Many animals lived there, but the most important animal to the natives was the buffalo. The Plains Indians traveled great distances while hunting buffalo. They were brilliant in their hunting technique. To hunt the buffalo, they might chase the huge animals into a stampeding herd. The buffalo would be driven to a cliff where they would fall off and die. The buffalo meat was often cut into strips and smoked over a fire. Some meat was dry, mixed with crushed berries, and stored for use during the cold winter season. This was called pemmican. Besides using the buffalo as a source of food, they used it for its skin. The buffalo's skin was watertight and made excellent boats, carry packs, and clothing. When women carried their babies with them, they used a cradle board, which was something like a backpack. Sometimes, women sewed beads or porcupine quills into the clothing. 12 or more of the tough buffalo skins were sewn together and placed over wooden poles. This made a temporary shelter called a teepee. The teepees had adjustable smoke flaps to help keep heat in or out. The teepees were easily rolled up and packed away when the group started to travel again. Not everyone lived in teepees, though. The Mandan and Pawnee tribes built dome-shaped earth lodges. The Plains tribes were known to be great fighters. They fought with great skill. In battle, they used shields made of hardened buffalo hide. Sometimes, they used clubs and tomahawks. Some Plains tribes honored their brave warriors or leaders with feathers to wear. Sometimes the chief wears a headdress with feathers in it.
I'm going to pretend to be a buffalo hunting Plains Indian. I want to earn feathers, wear buffalo skin clothes and moccasins, and eat pemmican. I'll live in a teepee while I travel, and I'll earn feathers from my axe.
Many of these tribes, again, were nomadic by nature. And so, of course, they had no understanding or concept of land ownership. Those customs came with farming and settlement, which, yes, had evolved in Western Europe perhaps thousands of years ago. But on the plains of what is today the United States, there had never been a need to develop farming societies. Yes, there were farming civilizations in the United States prior to Columbus. The Eastern Woodland Indians, the Cherokee people had all been using farming for many, many years. But the Plains Indians, no. The buffalo were so plentiful, they didn't need it. It provided everything they needed for their way of life. And so when European settlers moved west, with our culture of staking our claim and land ownership, many didn't consider these rights of dwelling that the natives held sacred because they didn't have a document to prove it. And so as migrants moved west, they claimed it. They said, "This is mine. I have a piece of paper to prove it." Settlement really began to increase with the discovery of gold in 1858 in Colorado. Colorado is a beautiful place. You've got to go see it. I've spent 4 summers there. I've explored most of it, but it's so big, I don't know if I'll ever see all of it. Someday I hope to climb all the 14,000 foot peaks. I've done about 6 of them. But there's too many, and most of them are too dangerous. But it's an amazing place. It's beautiful. Some of the biggest rivers I've ever been on are in Colorado. And it's just an amazing place. If you paddle through the Royal Gorge of the Arkansas, you'll be on some of the biggest rapids you've ever seen, through canyon walls thousands of feet tall with no escape. But as you pass through this canyon called the Royal Gorge, because it's just majestic, you'll also see an old gold mine deep in the middle of this canyon. Wow, how did it get there? It's kind of cool to see. And there's this little narrow gauge track. I just keep thinking, like, how on earth did these trains make it through this canyon without falling into the river? They probably did. There are probably constant landslides because it's a really unstable region too. There are mines like that everywhere. You know, this summer I got to see Silverton, a really beautiful town in Colorado. The elevation of this town is about 9,000 feet. You know, that's high enough that if you run and you're not acclimated, you'll pass out. Well, I put onto a river there called the Animas River. 26 miles of continuous class 4 and 5 whitewater. It was just beautiful to see. It was amazing. But again, there's a train that runs by the entire river. The train was built to mine. Silverton is called Silverton because silver was discovered there, and it was being mined out of Colorado. And there were places, many places like that, because you see, when gold was discovered, just like in California, it brought people to the region. Well, these mining camps, if you go and see them, were filthy. They're a mess. Maybe someday you'll get to go up to Mount Quandary. You should see it. It's a 14,000 foot peak in Colorado. You can drive up to 12,000 feet. I spent a scary night in high winds at 12,000 feet, sleeping in my car, hoping it wouldn't blow over. Climbed the mountain, the wind knocked me off my feet, strong gust of wind. I eventually had to back down, it was too scary. Somehow at the very top, there's a mine. I was like, how on earth did this thing get up there? It's there, trust me. I took pictures of it. Well, it's a mess. There's junk everywhere, even still over 100 years later. And it brought people from all over the world to these places.
By forcing Indians west of the Mississippi River, the United States thought that the Indians would be out of its way once and for all. But America was growing rapidly, and it wasn't long before pioneers began moving west across Indian land, heading for California and Oregon. They were followed by miners who trespassed on sacred Indian land in violation of treaties in search of gold and silver. They were followed by the railroads, which cut through the heart of Indian country and interfered with the migration of the buffalo, the Plains Indians' main source of food. What's worse, the railroads hired professional hunters to kill buffalo to provide food for the railroad workers, reducing the number available to Indians. Buffalo were also killed for their hides. After the skins were stripped from the animals, the carcasses were left to rot. Realizing the devastating effect the loss of the buffalo would have on Indians, the government encouraged people to kill as many buffalo as possible.
The government actually provided free guns and free ammunition to buffalo hunters, and they also provided revenue to purchase the buffalo skins, so that the incentive was there for people to go out and do that. And you had people that would go out and kill hundreds and thousands of them as an economic opportunity for themselves. And then there was also the train and the railroad system was just being put through this part of the country. And so you had a lot of people that would just come as tourists, and they would bring their rifles, and they allowed them to just shoot the buffalo from the train as they went by, just the way that I guess you would shoot at tin cans today.
Buffalo hunting by train was a favorite pastime of wealthy sportsmen who would ride out west in luxurious railroad cars and shoot countless buffalo from the safety of the slow-moving trains. Once numbering 60 million, the buffalo population was reduced to 1,000.
I almost forgot to mention, most of these people were men. Did you know that the Western states were the first states to allow women to vote? Wyoming, the very first state to allow women to vote. Why? Well, the ratio of men to women was dismal. You know, I always wondered if it was just a way to try to encourage women to move out west. Like, hey, come here, it's just a bunch of dudes, but we'll let you vote. And so there's never been as a degree of misogyny out west as there perhaps has been here. But now, in 1834, the United States government designated the Great Plains as one huge reservation. Yes, the Great Plains were seen as the province of the natives. That means Kansas, that means Oklahoma, that means the eastern parts of Colorado. That means everything. Texas. These are all to be a sacred place. And that was 1834. However, as more and more people began to move out west and began to lay claim, we started saying, no, actually, the Dakotas belong to the Sioux. No, wait, actually, the Cheyenne need to live around Sand Creek. No, wait, actually, We began to go back on our word because it was convenient. The reason I mentioned Sand Creek was it was the site of the very first massacre of Native Americans out west. 150 Cheyenne and Arapaho were camping at Sand Creek for the winter. It was common practice. They would stay there, then they would migrate with the buffalo in the spring. Well, the problem was this winter camp at Sand Creek was near the location of an American settlement. And there had been violence between the natives there and the settlers as tensions arose when the settlers attempted to claim this land as their own. And so the United States Army came in and killed everyone they saw. As you know, this isn't the first case of violence of Americans versus natives, but many of these stories like this are tragic. Many of these Cheyenne and Arapaho were unarmed men, women, and children. The next case was in the Dakotas. There was a migration route, kind of a common path that settlers traveled upon, called the Bozeman Trail. Well, the problem with this is the Bozeman Trail crossed right through the Sioux hunting grounds. And even though they didn't have a document claiming this is their territory, this is where the buffalo lived during the summer months. And if settlers pass right through the area, or heaven forbid we build a railroad right through the area, well, we're going to scare all the buffalo away. And the point that the Sioux were trying to make when Red Cloud actually went to the United States government and attempted to peacefully petition that we stop settlements in this region was, look, if you keep passing through and you either scare the buffalo off or kill them, you might as well be killing us. We can't live with this. And so the Treaty of Fort Laramie was passed. The United States closed the trail. We claimed, designated the Dakotas as one huge reservation. Now, there was one famous chief. I'm sure you've heard his name before. He actually refused to sign this treaty. He said, I don't trust these people. I mean, by this point, word had spread of the massacre at Sand Creek. By this point, most natives were aware of the Indian Removal Act. They weren't stupid. Sitting Bull certainly wasn't stupid. He wouldn't sign the Treaty of Fort Laramie. And he was actually the leader of the Hunkpapa Sioux. The Sioux were one of the largest tribes of Native Americans in the North Plains, in the North Country region. They were so large, in fact, there were factions within the tribe. He was the leader of one of these factions, the Hunkpapa.
Their way of life threatened, Indians responded by attacking anyone who trespassed on their land. In response, the army built forts throughout the plains from which soldiers could protect immigrants. But instead of pacifying the Indians, the presence of the forts angered them even more. In an effort to keep the peace, the United States met with the Plains tribes in 1851 and again in 1868 at Fort Laramie, Wyoming, to sign treaties. The Indians agreed to stop hostilities and stay on areas of land set aside for them, called reservations, in exchange for food and supplies. One Indian remarked at the time,
"We received many gifts, beef, bacon, medals, uniforms, but I don't know what good will come of it. How can a piece of paper stop all the bloodshed?"
Unfortunately, he was right. The peace would not last, and there were numerous incidents in the years that followed. In the Southwest, Indians, including the Navajo and Apache, led numerous raids against settlers and soldiers. The Apache were especially troublesome. Wishing to put an end to Indian resistance in the Southwest once and for all, General James Carleton ordered soldiers to kill any Apache man they ran across.
"All Apache men are to be killed whenever and wherever you can find them. If they surrender, remind them that they murdered innocent whites when they were trying to surrender. Tell them that you have no power to make peace, that you are there to kill them."
The Apache fled to rugged mountains in New Mexico and Arizona. The Navajo fled to a maze of inaccessible canyons and mesas in northern Arizona. In pursuit were soldiers led by Kit Carson, a famed scout. He and his men swept through the heart of Navajo country, capturing and killing as many Navajo as they could find. The Indians hid in caves high above the canyon floors, but it did them little good.
Another shot was heard, and another, and another. The firing gradually picked up, and soon it sounded like frying, with bullets hitting all over the cave. This went on nearly all afternoon. Then the firing ceased, but by that time nearly all the Navajos were killed. Men, women, children, young men and girls were all killed on the cliffs. Some just slid off the cliffs. At the bottom were piles of dead Navajo. Only a few survived. Blood could be seen from the top of the cliffs all the way down to the bottom.
Those who surrendered were forced marched 250 miles to a reservation in New Mexico, during which hundreds died or were killed.
"Women and children traveled on foot. That's why we called it the Long Walk. It was inhuman, because the Navajos, if they got tired and wouldn't continue to walk further, were just shot down. They had to keep walking all the time, day after day, for about 18 or 19 days, through all kinds of hardships, like tiredness and having injuries. And when those things happened, the people would hear gunshots in the rear, but they couldn't do anything about it. They just felt sorry for the ones being shot."
In 1868, the Red River War began. The Kiowa and the Comanche had made a living raiding and looting caravans as they passed west, attacking United States settlements that were encroaching upon their borders. The United States government responded by hunting these people like savages and crushing any resistance they saw. This was known as the Red River War. General George Armstrong Custer of the 7th Cavalry was tasked with serving as a peacekeeping force to prevent settlers from moving into the Dakotas. Remember, the Treaty of Fort Laramie said the Dakotas belonged to the Sioux. And it was his job to keep people out. However, instead of doing his job, he allowed miners and prospectors to go into the Black Hills of Dakota. And they found gold. And they found a lot of gold in this region. And instead of protecting the natives, as was his job, he began to sell plots of land on their territory. He had a pretty decent side business going, selling off mining rights in the Black Hills that belonged to the Sioux. And he was actually facilitating a gold rush. Sitting Bull was right all along. I wonder how many of his own people had told him to make peace, to try to live at peace. And I wonder how many people thought he was crazy when he was like, I don't trust these folks. He was exactly right. This perhaps is one of the more glorious moments for the natives in their long defeat. The Sioux lured Custer and his men into a box canyon. There aren't too many box canyons in the southeast. You got to really go into the sticks to find them. There's one on the Whitewater River in Sapphire, North Carolina. But you better be good with a map and a GPS. It's quite an undertaking to go find it, but it's there. It's a box canyon. If you go and see it, I still haven't made my way in there, but I've seen lots of video and picture. But if you go in there, there's one way in, there's one way out. There's a handful of places like that around here, but not many. But one reason that one way in, one way out concerns me a little bit is because of Box Canyons, because of Custer's story. He chased a handful of natives into this Box Canyon, and in this case, you have to see it, it's a big U. There's one way in, there's one way out. And then, in true dramatic fashion, 3,000 Sioux warriors show up on the ridge. And they cut off the exit. And they surround Custer and his men. And they kill every one of them. Now, that's Custer's famous last stand. After this famous battle, the Sioux were defeated eventually. Most were forced to either surrender or flee into Canada. Sitting Bull was forced to surrender in 1881.
Thank you.
Atrocities were committed by both sides. In 1864, U.S. soldiers attacked a peaceful Indian village near Sand Creek in Colorado, killing 150 Indians. Most of them were women and children, and their bodies were mutilated.
Sand Creek was a massacre because the attack, while it was still dark, they attacked villages of innocent men, women, and children, and they annihilated them and massacred them. And then we all know that they cut scalps, they cut private parts off Indian men, women, and children and put them on their saddles like trophies.
Even Kit Carson, who had fought the Indians in many battles, spoke out against the brutal attack.
"'Tain't natural for brave men to kill women and little children. No one but a coward or a dog would do it. All whites should be ashamed."
The Sand Creek Massacre angered Indians and stiffened their resolve to resist white encroachment, which was becoming more frequent as the United States expanded westward. In 1874, thousands of gold seekers poured onto Indian land in the Black Hills in South Dakota. The Black Hills were given to the Indians as part of the Fort Laramie Treaty of 1868. The Indians considered this area sacred, and the U.S. promised that no whites would ever be permitted to enter it. Yet the government did little to stop the gold seekers. To avoid possible hostilities, the government offered to buy the Black Hills. When the Indians refused to sell, the government ordered them onto their reservations. Many refused, so the army sent soldiers into the plains to force them back. Indians were hunted down, and if they refused to surrender, they were killed. One of the officers in charge of hunting down the Indians was Lieutenant Colonel George Armstrong Custer, a fearless and brilliant officer who wanted to achieve a spectacular victory over the Indians. Blinded by his ambition for glory, Custer attacked an Indian village without first finding out how many braves he would be up against. What looked like a village of several hundred was actually a summer gathering of tribes numbering as many as 12,000. Custer's men were outnumbered 10-1 and were wiped out in less than an hour of frantic fighting in what has become known as the Battle of the Little Bighorn.
The Battle of the Little Bighorn may have seemed like a major victory for the Indians, but it wasn't. In fact, it was the beginning of the end.
When news of Custer's defeat reached the East, newspapers demanded that something be done.
"This was a cold-blooded, barbarous massacre of men. When will the government realize that Indians are not men?"
The battle wasn't a massacre at all. Custer and his men had attacked the Indians first.
The Battle of the Little Bighorn was not a massacre by the Indians. It was a battle where Custer came in armed with one of the most highly respected cavalry units in the United States Army. That was the 7th Cavalry, one of the finest fighting units. And General Custer, who was under commission from President Grant, knew that in order to correct the problem, the Indians had to be put on reservations. And so clearly, he sent his best to defeat the Indians, and President Grant's best, which is the 7th Cavalry, were wiped out in a fair fight because he underestimated the strength of the Indians. And it's one of the few times that the Indian tribes united against the United States.
One of the Indian leaders that day was Sitting Bull, a great Sioux chief.
"All my warriors were brave and knew no fear. The soldiers who were killed were brave men too, but they had no chance to fight or run away. They were surrounded too closely by our many warriors. We did not go out of our own country to kill them. They came to kill us and got killed themselves."
In 1881, Helen Hunt Jackson wrote, an expose called A Century of Dishonor. She represented the minority opinion in the United States that what we were doing was wrong. And while I'm proud to point out there were folks who believed that back then, most didn't care. It was the policy of the United States government to encourage or facilitate assimilation. We wanted the natives to begin farming, to begin living as we did. In fact, with the passage of the Dawes Act in 1887, we required they do this. We told them to give up their way of life, to live on plots of land that we designated. And essentially what this allowed was we took two-thirds of their land and we divided up the other third among family-sized plots belonging to the natives. And they received no compensation for this until much later. There's the book. It's on my shelf if you want to borrow it. It's just called The Century of Dishonor, the classic expose of Native Americans. But as we were talking about, perhaps the most tragic thing we have to understand is that the buffalo were destroyed. Went from a population of hundreds of millions to almost none. So, today I'd like to talk about the largest mass shooting in American history. And no, I'm not talking about the recent events in LA, though those were certainly tragic. 120 people lost their lives to a single shooter. The LA shooting, yeah. Wait, it wasn't 120, it was it 57? 59, yeah, sorry, I had that wrong. Yeah, so 59 people lost their lives, many more wounded. It's been called the worst mass shooting in recent American history, and perhaps the worst shooting in American history is this, known as the Battle of Wounded Knee. And as I said, Sitting Bull was arrested in 1881. He refused to be taken prisoner indefinitely and tried to escape, and he was killed when police attempted to arrest him. The 7th Cavalry was sent to round up the Sioux for relocation, and a shot rang out, and I'll go ahead and show it to you, and it resulted in the deaths of about 300 men, women, and children, mostly unarmed.
Thank you.
As a result of Custer's defeat and the public outcry that followed it, the government sent even more soldiers to put down the Indians once and for all. Within 5 years, not a single Indian was living freely on the plains. Greatly outnumbered, beaten down, and starving, the Indians had no other choice but to resign themselves to reservation life. But the bloodshed didn't end there. In the 1880s, a new religious practice called the Ghost Dance swept the plains. By performing it, during which dancers entered a trance-like state, many Indians believed that all their dead relatives would come back to life, new herds of buffalo would appear, and that the whites would go away. Agents supervising the reservation didn't understand the Ghost Dance and became frightened, thinking that it was a war dance and that the Indians were about to attack. Troops were called in. Fearing an army attack, 350 Indians fled the Sioux Reservation in South Dakota. They were eventually tracked down and surrounded by 500 soldiers near Wounded Knee Creek. The Indians, many of them old men, women, and children, agreed to surrender. But when the soldiers attempted to disarm them, someone fired a shot. The soldiers reacted by shooting into the crowd of Indians, killing as many as 240 of them, including women and children.
Once it started, it was too late to stop. You know, they went into a frenzy. They started shooting the women, children, and, you know, they didn't stop until they had everyone that they could get.
The soldiers fired volley after volley into the helpless crowd. Some Indians tried to escape.
We tried to run, but they shot us like we were buffalo. I know there are some good white people, but the soldiers must be mean to shoot children and women. Indian soldiers would not do that to white children.
This tragic incident was to become known as the Wounded Knee Massacre. Today, all that remains at Wounded Knee is this small cemetery honoring those who had fallen here more than a century ago. Hundreds of visitors, most of them non-Indian, visit here every day, paying their respects to the victims of this tragedy. But Wounded Knee today is not just a cemetery. It is also a symbol, marking the final chapter in the 400-year conflict with Native Americans in this country.
All right. And so we're going to get into talking about cowboys and cowboy culture. But first off, got a neat little activity for you guys. So, the myth of the cowboy, as you know, is much bigger than even perhaps the reality. To be fair, this tradition of driving cattle from the open range into a town where they can be processed and made into beef is an old tradition. Mexican settlers had been doing this for many years. In fact, vaqueros had long been a part of Mexican culture, and we learned this way of life from them. In fact, the very way that cowboys dressed was borrowed from vaqueros. The very way cowboys spoke, the way they lived on the go. Again, most of those cultures were borrowed from Mexican settlers. Cowboys weren't really in demand until railroads, that is, in the United States, that is, until railroads made their way out west, where cowboys could drive their herds of cattle to the nearest railroad town. But after the Civil War, as our population was growing due to immigration, there was a greater demand for beef. And as we now had access to all of these open spaces where cows could be allowed to graze openly, there was a brief period of history where the long drive and the open grazing was very common. One of the things that made this possible was the cow town, you know, where shipping yards and rail lines would meet and where cowboys would bring their cattle that had been grazing on the open range to these towns to be loaded up on trains and brought back to packing cities such as Chicago. So one of the major cattle routes was called the Chisholm Trail. It came from San Antonio, Texas, all the way up through Kansas, which Kansas is huge if you've never been. I've actually passed through this area. Maybe I'll think to show you some pictures. But day in the life of a cowboy. The real heyday of this was between 1866 and 1885. So less than 20 years, where there were about 55,000 cowboys on the plains, where open grazing was very common. But did you know that American cowboys, and Bailey was exactly right, were a quarter African American? Many of them were Hispanic. And so really, you know, the West was kind of a neat place where folks were mixing and moving out here for all the same reasons. The hours were long, the days were hard. You had to be good on a horse, you had to be great with ropes, and you had to be pretty smart to live out in the wild like that, otherwise you just wouldn't last long. Every spring, cattle would be rounded up, cowboys would have to go out and find strays. So open grazing means that the herd of cattle worked just like the buffalo. They were essentially set free to find food for themselves. And then they'd be rounded up. Cowboys would go out and find them. And then they would migrate the whole herd into town together. This sounds rather chaotic, and really it is. I mean, you basically set an entire herd of cattle free. And then every spring you've got to go round up the entire herd. And you've got to get them to move in one direction. It's not a simple job. So to designate whose cows belong to whom, they would brand them. Because if herds are going to openly graze, they're going to mix, and they'll be all mixed up. And so they would brand them to mark their ownership. So this painting's pretty neat. It's called Riders in the Storm. But the long drive itself might take as much as 3 months. During this time, cowboys would be in the saddle all day, dawn till dusk. They'd sleep on the ground. They'd have to bathe in the rivers. It's a rough way of life. But it's led to so many legends in our culture. I don't know if you've ever heard of the cowboy celebrity, Wild Bill Hickok. He staged the Wild Bill show. What was it called? The Buffalo Bill Show. It was a cowboy show. He traveled the country like a circus. And he would put on this show. And he had real Sioux warriors versus real cowboys. And they would stage mock battles and entertain the crowd. Famous celebrities like Wild Bill or Calamity Jane. Common performers. But now, the cowboy era came to an end due to a number of reasons. Partially, overgrazing. You know, you let these cows free, they just eat whatever, wherever. And as the population of the West began to increase, no one wants a herd of cattle going through their farm, because they're going to eat everything in your farm. And so ranchers tended to use barbed wire to fence in their farms, to keep cattle off. Barbed wire was becoming cost effective due to techniques that we'll talk about soon. And because of that, the public land where cows could graze was growing smaller and smaller. And so now if you go out west, you'll see huge ranches, some the size of Henderson County. In fact, many the size of Henderson County. Huge things. Exits all their cell. But they're fenced off. Keep the cows out. And it's practical. But it also contributed to the end of the cowboy era.